settled before we start the clock. Mr. Reardon, there are a lot of issues in this case, and I generally am going to hold both parties to the 20 minutes. So in your arguments today, don't be remiss or make sure you say something about what I'm calling the witness tampering and false answer counts, the 15-12. I know there's a lot of things to cover, but make sure you have some time to talk about those counts in particular.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Honor. My opening line was going to be, this is a complex case with perhaps more issues than we can discuss at length this morning. So I will attempt to keep my remarks focused and certainly take into account the court's counsel in regard to those two counts. I do intend to begin with what I believe is an enormously consequential issue here concerning the law of trade secrets, because a large part of the government's case at trial consisted of its contention that a company can take what it considers a trade secret, sell it without either any limitations or limitations that run out in a certain time period, give it to another company, sell it, who is completely free under the testimony here to do anything it wants with it. And in fact, it did sell it to third and fourth parties. And yet Company A can still claim trade secret status for what it sold and given away, and a criminal prosecution can be based on the notion that even though this has been disseminated to people who can do whatever they want with it, it still remains the trade secret of Company A for the purpose of civil and criminal liability. That's just absolutely wrong. I mean, Monsanto said in 1984 that once you disclose the data to another party, then it's no longer a trade secret. And what the government did was attempt to seize on the notion of the word public in the EEA and say, oh, you can sell it to your biggest competitor, who's the only one who's going to understand it and make use of it, and yet it could still be a trade secret because the general public isn't aware of it, even though what would the general public do with titanium dioxide technology?
And make Oreo cookies out of it.
And make Oreo cookies out of it. And you just think about the notion of criminal liability in this situation. Company A sells its technology to Company B. Company B is free to do whatever it wants and sells it to Company C. Company A comes along and says, we're going to get the government to prosecute you, or we'll sue you civilly, because we believed that Company B wouldn't sell it to you. And based on our subjective mens rea, that we didn't think they'd sell it to you, you're now guilty of a trade secret violation.
Mr. Root, can you, this is an important issue. Can you enlighten me, because this is complicated, how did this issue get to the district court? And what procedurally, how did it get to the district court? What was its ruling?
Well, let me state this way. It got to the jury because it was a central contention of the government. They explicitly stated that a competitor is not the public, so a competitor can have it, and it's no problem.
And were there arguments over the instructions?
And there was a point in which the defense attempted to demonstrate in the testimony that this material had been sold to competitors, and there was an objection that was sustained. But let me get to what I suspect the court's getting at. Was the court asked to rule on an instruction that said that if information has been sold to a competitor, it is no longer, as a matter of law, a trade secret? There was not a request for that instruction, but there were objections both to the government's instructions and to a series of instructions, and the defense proffered a series of instructions that would have gotten to the same thing, that is to say that they did have request instructions that material which is public, which is gained by reverse engineering, which is gained by, when information is disclosed through carelessness, that all of that strips it of trade secret status, and the court refused all of those instructions. Your Honor, I was thinking of posing it this way. under the government's theory and the instructions that the court gave, this case was a slam dunk for the government. And the reason why is the government said to the jury that the all of the technology and the Ashtabula technology remained a trade secret. Well, if that's true, the defense was, oh, we used all of that technology. We absolutely exploited it because it was our belief that it was not a trade secret because it had been sold. The government took the position that it is a trade secret. If the court and the jury, in our view, had been correctly instructed, the instructions would have said, in essence, Ashtabula, as a matter of law, is not a trade secret. The man who designed all of DuPont's plants thereafter, up through Xuan Yin in 1989 and 1990, Mr. Mayerly, was entitled to take that non-trade secret information and apply his experience and skill in engineering all of DuPont's plants since then. And that's okay. That's perfectly all right. And what the government might have then had to do is identify something in these documents that wasn't either drawn from Ashtabula, because there was a lot of it that was not a problem, a product of Mayerly's skill and ability and experience. And then identifying that, then prove that that information hadn't been disclosed to contractors whose confidentiality agreements expired in as little as seven years. That would have been a very tough case, and it would have been a fair trial, but a very different trial than one in which these instructions are denied. I think that the government's 28-J letter yesterday is significant, because what it says is that Congress acted not to change the law, but to make the law absolutely clear. Reverse engineering under the trade secret law was always permitted. Independent derivation was always permitted. Under the law, if somebody has a compilation and you know the public elements of it, and you can figure out the compilation, the way they were combined, that's perfectly okay. That's not a trade secret violation either.
So my concern with this is what I understood is the district court rejected those instructions, not because they were correct as a matter of law, because I think they are correct as a matter of law, but that they didn't apply to the situation, the facts here, facts on the ground in this case.
Well,
they weren't reverse engineering, and they weren't taking stuff from the public documents and public disclosures. They had internal documents that two former engineers for DuPont had in their possession, and that's what they were selling. So explain that to me, because I thought the district court just said these instructions are not supported by the evidence.
Well, the district court seemed to say, and the government maintains here, they were not necessary. But let's take the key instruction on the right of a employee to leave a company, go to a company, and use all the experience and skill that they gained in during their tenure with that company, in this case 30 years by Mayerly, and use that for a competitor. That was a critical principle that would have applied to a great deal of what we're talking about here, because one of the things the evidence supported was that the documents that we're talking about were not used in the development of these plans for Hong Kong, that they did. There was testimony that they did not play a significant role there. And in terms of reverse engineering, why couldn't a jury conclude that using the Ashtabula technology that Mayerly during his 30 years or thereafter reverse engineered any number of modern improvements on the titanium dioxide process? So that is why the government, and here as well, the the government still maintains that in this appeal that Ashtabula remained a trade secret, and it was the easiest route for a conviction by a jury because the defense got up and said, we relied on Ashtabula. You know, that's Mayor Lee gave a statement to the, and wrote an email, gave a statement to the FBI that said he believed Ashtabula was no longer protected, and he built on that. And as I say, he was the engineer of
Swanyan. So Ashtabula, just to clarify, Ashtabula was sold, and it was sold under an agreement that required confidentiality for a certain period of time, but that period of time had expired.
Yes, the period of time was indisputably 15 years, and in fact, interestingly enough, the government actually called in a witness from Cristal, who was the successor owner of Ashtabula after it passed through Millennium and SCM, and they said, it's ours, we can do anything we want with it, we can print it in the newspaper, we haven't done it yet, but we can print it in the newspaper. And what the government is saying is that, of course, if you sold your technology to competitor A, and there's D and E and F out there, you're going to continue to attempt to maintain it as confidential rather than have it get to D, E, and F. So the company has a perfect right to maintain it as confidential. It has a perfect right to say if somebody took it improperly, they stole it. But stealing confidential information is not stealing trade secrets if the trade secrets have been disclosed under the Monsanto rule. And, of course, in May, the Congress passed a statute that made clear that you lose trade secret status not merely because, not only when to lose trade secret status does not require that the public know about it generally, but any person who could benefit from it financially. And our position is certainly not that was the law, that is the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, not that Congress deviated from that in 1996, eliminated the core of trade secret law, and then reinstated it in May. They took that action to make it clear that Monsanto and the Uniform Trade Secret Act have always been the underpinnings of the EEA, and which this court said in Chung, it said that you look to the Uniform Trade Secrets Act for the definition of trade secrets. There are a couple, we have further to go on this. Let me turn to those two counts. I think what I would say is that the notion that you commit a civil lawyer commits a crime when he or she files an answer to a complaint that denies the merits of the complaint, they commit a crime if subsequently it turns out that the complaint is meritorious, was discussed at length, I think, by a number of the opinions in the Bonds case. And I just think that I don't think there's any precedent, we couldn't find any, for the notion that a lawyer, a party who denies the allegations in the complaint can therefore be criminally responsible if subsequently a criminal jury finds that the allegations in the complaint were meritorious.
Let me ask you about that. So make it a much simpler case, some sort of sexual assault type case, civil lawsuit is filed, and the two defendants who are accused of committing sexual assault, they have an email exchange, some kind of exchange, say, look, let's make sure we tell our lawyer to tell him the answer, we were not in the house on the night of the incident. So an answer is filed, and in the answer it says, the parties, they deny any liability. In fact, they were not even in the house on the night when this alleged incident occurred. And that is factually inaccurate. It's knowingly a false statement that is put into the answer. Why wouldn't that fall into 1512?
In a civil case that in which they're discussing the position that they're going to have their lawyers take in that particular case?
Correct. They said, let's make sure we tell our lawyer something that's false. We're going to say we weren't even in the house. And so the lawyer, having no idea, files the answer, and the answer is false because, in fact, they were in the house. So I question, why wouldn't that be a conspiracy to violate 1512?
Well, you're certainly loading the question by saying that what they wrote to one another is,
right,
this is false.
Correct, and that would be a jury determination as to what that means. I guess what I'm trying to get the sense is I appreciate what you say about lawyers that just filing a denial, and that can't always lead to liability. That makes total sense to me. But at the same time, there has to be a converse at some point would have to be true. Otherwise, lawyers and their clients could fill complaints filed with the court or depositions filled with lies, and there's no consequence for that.
Well,
so where do we draw the line here?
Well, here's one line to draw. In the example you gave, Your Honor, I assume that you're saying that the conduct that was charged, that would be charged as a possible obstruction, is the conversation between the two.
Correct.
Okay. You're not saying that the act which could be charged is the statement in the complaint, in the indictment.
Correct, but my belief in this case is the conspiracy charge was the charge here, correct?
But I believe that the charge here was conspiring to put a statement in the response to the complaint. I believe I should look at this a little more carefully, but I believe that the theory that the court is espousing, and which I think the government espoused in its brief, is clearly a variance or a constructive amendment of the indictment, because it posed the question of the civil pleading. I don't believe it posed the question of communications between the two defendants separate from the pleading. So I'll leave it at the moment. The second count is different, because the second count is 11, I believe, is about a conversation between the parties. Mr. Liew and the other Mr. Liew, in the context of their discussing an investigation by a civil an investigator for DuPont, not an official. And I simply say, Your Honor, that when you look at the content of that, so much of which was absolutely correct. You don't have to speak to an investigator from DuPont. It can have consequences and so forth. It just doesn't add up to obstruction of that civil action. I think it's mostly protected. I do want to make at least brief remarks on the remaining two issues, very briefly on the Brady issue. And my position would simply be this. When you get an affidavit, a declaration from an attorney that says he sat in on interviews of his client, and his client made exculpatory statements, and he's a critical figure in this case, that were not reflected in the FBI 302s, and somebody says, on that basis, Your Honor, I'm asking for raw notes of the FBI agent, on what conceivable basis would you not either order disclosure? Because if it's exculpatory, the defense should have it. If it's not exculpatory, that should become clear, and the allegation should be cleared up. Or at a minimum, if there's some claim of privilege or privacy, order an in-camera inspection by the court.
And you would have no problem if we were to say district court, remand that issue to district court, that the judge is in the best position to make that call because he lived through this trial and he can make that amendment.
That's the remedy we're asking for, Your Honor. The disclosure to the district court.
I just wanted you to get to sentencing.
Here it is. DuPont comes in and says, we cannot tell this court that we suffered any loss. Okay? If they didn't suffer any loss, then the guideline range for this sentence is 18 to 20 months, 21 months on the trade secrets charges. 22 level enhancement. Not based on any loss. There's a concession that none has been demonstrated as to DuPont, but on the notion that there was a gain in terms terms of the amount of money paid to Mr. Liew. The two have to be equivalent. It can't be, you can't say there isn't loss, so we'll do it by gain. The gain has to be a reasonable estimation of the loss. And let me say this, the fact that the state and the government has come in on appeal and come up with a theory that has no support in the record and was never mentioned below, which is that, oh, it was his conduct that prevented DuPont from going on and getting their own contract, when DuPont, the record demonstrates, declined to go forward because it would have meant licensing technology in China, which it refused to do. So when we're talking about something without support in the record that was never mentioned by the government, DuPont, or the trial judge at sentencing, you know, you don't have a legitimate basis for those 22-level enhancements. And I'm right at that time.
Thank you. We'll give you 2 minutes for rebuttal.
I appreciate that.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Mary Chi Chan, and I represent the United States in this appeal. This court should affirm all the judgments below. To begin with, the defendants raised the Ashtabula defense at trial, and the jury rejected it. And it rejected it for very good cause, because all five trade secrets in this case postdated the 1967 Ashtabula.
Ashtabula.
I know, in Ohio. I know, and actually, I knew that. Ashtabula technology by 20 to 30 years. And the defendant's own expert acknowledged that none of these trade secrets were publicly available. There's a very big difference between these trade secrets. These trade secrets involved, for example, blueprints, essentially, flow diagrams of Edgemoor plant. The Edgemoor plant was capable of producing 100,000 metric tons per year from ore that was mixed grade. That means titanium content as low as 60%, where titanium ore, the ore, constitutes 40 to 50% of the cost structure. The Ashtabula plant was able only to produce 27,000 metric tons per year from titanium content that had to be 90% or higher. That is a huge difference. So to the extent that the defendants want to make this all about Ashtabula, it simply is not borne out by the record. Monsanto also doesn't support them in the way that they'd like it to. There is no Monsanto rule that simply says that as long as Monsanto was a takings case, so it concerned the property rights of, in that case, Monsanto, vis-a-vis one party, which was the EPA. And that case said that, with respect to the EPA, it wasn't a taking if the EPA disclosed data that Monsanto had voluntarily provided to the EPA, knowing that it was a possibility that the EPA would disclose it or use it for its competitors. It had nothing to say about whether some third party or foreign power would be able to take that data with impunity if the EPA did not exercise its ability to, for example, disclose it or use it. If the EPA didn't do anything about it, it had nothing to say about whether some third party or foreign entity could then take that, and it was no longer a trade secret for those purposes. So yes, the government agrees that with respect to Sherwin-Williams, with respect to SCM, with respect to Cristal, DuPont has no claim of trade secret. However, the issue is whether it has its trade secret with respect to, here in this case, Mr. Liew and Pangong and the people who were charged in this case. The other thing is that the government's position is completely consistent with the definition of trade secret that Congress passed. And that is that there have to be reasonable measures, not absolute measures, taken to keep something secret. That means, for example, that if you give it to somebody and everybody actually keeps it secret, if Cristal actually keeps it secret, those measures mean that that is still secret with respect to the larger competitors. If, for example, it's data that all the competitors generally know, then it's not a trade secret. So the government's position here wasn't that that the entire public, or you know, that I, as an individual citizen who doesn't know anything about engineering, would have to understand the plans for it to be a trade secret, but that just because DuPont knew and because Cristal knew, those are two players in a highly competitive industry that includes many, many other players, and that none of those other players knew. There was testimony from Mr. Gibney, who worked at Tromax, who said that, you know, he had worked in the industry for a very long time and had never until his participation in this case had any access or insight into the DuPont process. And they wanted to have that access. In fact, his company spent 5 years and $25 million trying to replicate DuPont's high-pressure oxidation system and failed and had to write that off. So I would contend that there was sufficient evidence in this case to support the trade secret convictions and that the jury instructions were adequate to cover the defense theories. It allowed the defense to argue as they did all the things that they wanted to do. And Judge Wardlaw made a very good point, which was that, in fact, the requested instruction about reverse engineering was premised upon the idea that the parties were reverse engineering, not that the secret or trade secret could be reverse engineered, but it was actually reverse engineered. And there was no foundation in evidence of that. Again, trade secrets 2, 3, 4, and 5 are proprietary documents that this court has before it, blueprints of the Edgemoor facility, a 400-plus page document from Juan Yi from 1985, the 1994 accession report holding the most recent technology on the TICL-4 mixing. Mixing correlation formula that nobody else had. It was proprietary to DuPont. It should also be pointed out that there was not the instructions for the trade secret specifically said that personal skills, talents, or abilities that an employee develops at his place of employment are not trade secrets. So to the extent that they wanted to argue that that's what McGraw or Tim Spindler were doing, they could and they did, but it was simply not borne out by the evidence. I'd like to move on now to the count 10, which is the false answer. And I think that Judge Owens is exactly right, and that is the position, and that was what was charged. The indictment specifically charged a conspiracy to have the result be a false answer. And the date range of the indictment starts off with the date the complaint was filed. That's April 6th, 2001, and ends with
2011, I believe.
I'm sorry, 2011, and May 11th, 2011, when the answer was filed. And between that time, the evidence showed that just 2 days after the complaint was filed, Mr. Liew, in this case, told the other Mr. Liew not to disclose the existence of McGraw or Spindler or any involvement of DuPont. He asked another employee to search for patents to create a list of patents. He asked another employee to scrub USAPTI servers of all DuPont material. And then on April 25th, he himself met with lawyers from DuPont. And he's... Yes.
So that was the conduct that was charged in those two counts, the count of the obstruction of justice and the witness tampering. As I understand the obstruction of justice count, it was conspiracy to file a false answer in a civil litigation, correct?
That's right. So
it was a civil litigation filing. And is it your position that the answer was material to the civil litigation?
It's our position that the defendant believed that it was, that he wanted to put a material falsehood in the answer to misshape the facts in response to the lawsuit.
So you can criminalize filing denials and affirmative defenses in civil litigation if the answer isn't even material, but the defendant thinks it is.
Where there's a corrupt intent to do so, and that it's a reasonable, I think, belief in this case. And
what if the government had never filed a criminal action? Because here we have this civil action, and nothing's yet been proved. Nothing's gone forward. DuPont hasn't proved that the thing was false or not false. And it's only because the government comes in and later files this criminal action that you can make this allegation.
Well, I think that's
what I have in mind. Let me just tell you the bigger picture I have in mind.
Sure.
So, because there are many, many, I mean, I did this kind of litigation, civil litigation, and I'm on the mines for 16 years. So many, many, many statutes that either a private entity can file a civil action or a government anti-rigid government entity could file a criminal action, securities litigation, antitrust litigation, all sorts of litigation across the board of federal government. And it seems to me that these counts stand. We're facing a real slippery slope into criminalizing a lot of normal civil litigation practices that, you know, the civil litigation procedures deal with. They deal with ethical violations and Rule 11, and they deal with sanctions and all of that. You're making them criminal now by charging these kinds of charges.
I understand your concern, and here's why you shouldn't be concerned. First of all, this is a conspiracy count, and it doesn't deal with just attorneys crafting a denial, but it deals with defendants coming up with, as Judge Owen's example said, falsehoods to base this on.
Judge Owen's example was a criminal suit. I'm talking civil lawsuits now, civil litigation.
Well, the 1512 doesn't make that distinction. It deals with official proceedings, and it doesn't exempt civil proceedings. And I think that it's a very dangerous idea that the defendants have premised their argument on, which is that zealous advocacy allows you to lie. You may have good faith disputes about what the truth is.
That's a dangerous idea, counsel. That's not a dangerous idea. That's what happens every day in civil litigation, I can assure you. And it's whether the witnesses are getting out and then not telling the whole truth to their counsel or however it happens. It happens, whether it happens sloppily or not sloppily. But, and a lot of times, an affidavit and an answer is not even material, or it's never proven, and there's no consequence.
Well, I understand that. In this case, I should say also that these are factual matters that were passed upon by the jury. Rule 8, which was not in front of the jury, of the Civil Federal Rules of Procedure specifically state that even in denials, there has to be a good faith behind what you deny. And you can have fair disputes about the facts. But in this case, there is no doubt that the evidence, there is no doubt that Mr. Liew and Mr. McGarrell, who had emailed about Kuan Yin over 100 times between 2007 and 2010, knew that they had possession of materials relating to DuPont and Kuan Yin, and knew that they were relying on these, and took efforts to hide that.
Okay, one more specific question on the witness.
Yes.
What testimony is Liew alleged to have influenced on the witness tampering count?
The testimony, well, Mr. Liew, when he went and spoke with the attorneys, he said that
DuPont attorneys. That was the charge, right?
Right. That he said
DuPont.
That.
Okay, go on.
So he said that there was. Sorry about the interruption. There were no DuPont people involved in this, and he knew very well that Mr. McGraw and Mr. Spittler were involved, and that there were a lot of DuPont materials. In fact, he had those, and that's how it began, which is that Chevron found those DuPont materials on his computer. So he went and lied, and he testified at trial.
Do the informal interviews with the DuPont representatives constitute testimony in an official proceeding?
Yes, because it was relating to the civil federal lawsuit. So that 1512 specifically permits that and creates that scope. So this court would view something, I think, very novel, which is to carve out civil federal proceedings from 1512, which is, you know, the majority probably of the business before the federal courts, and saying that that would be fine if you want to sort of misconstrue and make fraudulent evidence or suppress evidence, that's all okay. And I don't think it would chill zealous advocacy, and I don't think that's what actually exists, to say that you have to make a good faith representation on facts. You might have a general denial, but here what we had wasn't simply a general denial. It wasn't doing the defense that they actually proffered at the criminal trial, which was to say, you know what, we have these DuPont materials. We don't consider these things to be trade secrets because of Ashtabula or because the patents or because of the contractors. What they said was, we don't have anything having to do with DuPont at all, which they knew was wrong. They knew it was false, and it is true that none of this necessarily would have come out to light until the end of the trial, but that's true for any sort of perjury or subordination of perjury case, which is we allow people to testify on their own behalf in criminal trials or at depositions. But if we find out later on that what they said was a flat lie, as this was, then that puts them on the hook for criminal charges.
Do you want to talk about the Brady issue?
I would like to talk about the Brady issue. First of all, the standard of review for this should be abusive discretion because this was a discovery issue. This came up in a very strange context, as the briefing indicated, which was in the middle of sort of the dispute about the loss amount. The defense said, well, we believe that the loss amount should be zero, despite what the jury found, despite the fact that they had to find that there was economic value to this and that the defendants intended to economically injure DuPont or knew that it would injure DuPont. There's no loss, and here's why you know that there's no loss, because Houston, who is Mr. Spittler's attorney, puts in a declaration that says that Spittler believed that these things were worthless because they got shipped to him, and that he therefore believed it to be worthless. Now, this then became not only the basis for the request for a zero loss amount or very low loss amount, but the request for the government post-trial in the context of sentencing to produce rough notes of the agent who had written the 302, and the 302 had already, prior to trial, long before any of this came up, been disclosed to the defense, and that there were some sort of alleged inconsistencies there. There really weren't inconsistencies there because the 302 specifically said that he believed that he had found these materials that he had gotten from DuPont along his personal belongings. To the extent that there are inconsistencies about or additional data about or information or allegations that DuPont had sent this to him and then his belief about what that meant, well, those are things that Houston sort of attributed to it, but the government said, okay, well, let's bring him into the evidentiary hearing, as you asked, and let's flesh this out. And the defense said, no, we don't want to. We don't need to bring Houston in. Let's not bring him in. And perhaps they said this because the incontested, uncontested information about the HR, for example, record of Spittler showed that Spittler had retired 9 years after he left Altamira. So that was slightly inconsistent with what Mr. Houston's declaration said. The fact that he said it was completely worthless was, again, flatly refuted by the fact that he collected thousands of dollars in cash from Mr. Liew for these pieces of information, and that he was part of DuPont, so he knew what these things were worth, and he knew that he was subject to confidentiality provisions by the company. So Mr. Liew and USAPTI said, no, we don't want to actually have an evidentiary hearing. So in light of all of that, it was not abuse of discretion for the district court to say, okay, you have not met your initial burden of showing that there's some credible evidence that the government has something that's material that is withheld from you. And so we're not going to go there. I think that the district court was correct in doing that. It did not abuse its discretion. And even though we didn't have to get into a materiality analysis for the reasons I set out in the brief, with respect to Houston's representations, there was no materiality there. If I can quickly move on to the finding of loss, the district court also did not clearly err in finding that there was a loss. It basically had to because this was required by the jury's verdict. But it was also because the jury had to find it implicit in that, and this is also supported by the Howley case from the Sixth Circuit, these possession counts required the jury to find that the thing that was the trade secret that was stolen or possessed not only had independent economic value from being secret, but that Mr. Liew and USAPTI believed that they were going to or knew that they were going to economically injure DuPont, the owner of these trade secrets, by taking it to the economic benefit of somebody else other than DuPont. So that was implicit in their findings. And in fact, it's pretty clear, and the PSR specifically says this, that the defendants intended DuPont to lose something. They intended, and intended loss is a valid basis under USSG.
But that doesn't mean that they actually lost something. It could be an intended future
Well, they lost the opportunity for that, Your Honor. I mean, they also lost, for example, if they had wanted to sell those trade secrets 2 through 5, those pieces of paper and those documents, they could have. It was their asset, so they did lose something. It was very hard to assess exactly what that was because...
Tell me again, how was it assessed?
How it actually ended up being assessed was based upon gain, and that this is where the dispute was. So the gain was based upon the $28 million that ended up in Mr. Liew's pocket. And the court said, okay, look, we can even subtract out the $6 million that maybe went to expenses paying all the employees who were not in, you know, really qualified engineers with TiO2 experience. Let's take that out, but the range would be $22 million to $28 million. That's gain. And the guidelines specifically say that gain is a proper basis for assessing or estimating loss, a reasonable estimate of a loss, when you cannot otherwise reasonably assess what it would be. In this case, I think the district court did not clearly err in saying, well, a lot of these things are counterfactuals because, in fact, DuPont spent, the evidence said, showed that they invented the process in 1948. They continually spent $150 million improving this between 1948 and, you know, 1994, the last trade secret at issue here. And how are you going to estimate exactly how much money went into this? How much is the worth of are these trade secrets? That's really difficult to do, and it becomes speculative at some point. DuPont was on the precipice of putting a 200,000 metric tons per year plant in Dongying, China in 2005. They had announced this, and they were going through the approvals process, and that whole thing got scuttled once at the same period of time. Mr. Liew came to Hong Kong and said, listen, I can get you the technology that they won't license to you. It won't be a wholly owned DuPont factory, and I'm going to make you and supply you with the designs for a 100,000 metric tons per year facility. So it's pretty clear that if they had been able to do that, which they had not succeeded in yet at the time of sentencing, putting that in, that would be taking, or the intent there was to take away 100,000 metric tons per year of business from DuPont. How much does that profit come down to profit? It's hard to say. It's $3,000 per ton of this TiO2 is the cost it costs, but how much is the profit? So it became speculative. So the district court did not clearly err in finding that there was a loss. It was hard to actually establish what that was. There was clearly an intended loss, and that gain was a proper way to estimate that.
Captain, we're in the red, but I do have one question for you, and Mr. Brown, I'll give you 3 minutes. On the topic of this new statute that's now been amended,
yes.
If this case were to be charged tomorrow, let's say,
yes.
A lot of the issues we're talking about today that Mr. Reardon has raised, which are very important in this case, would they apply to cases going forward, or is the statute going to change how these cases are being prosecuted?
No, I don't think so. I mean, that's why I don't think it really changes the government's position. The government's position wasn't that reverse engineering constituted misappropriation. It's just that it didn't apply in this case, and that the trade secret definition really encompassed that. What it does is clarify that public doesn't refer to just any old Joe.
I guess what I'm saying is that if they were to publish a decision in this case, would it have any meaning going forward in light of the amendments by Congress?
I think it would. And I ask for an affirmance. Thank you.
3 minutes, Mr. Burton.
Sometimes denigrate the role of oral argument. This one convinces me how valuable it can be. Count 10. The complaint alleged that
the indictment.
Liew and Mayor Lin and Yusuf Popti misappropriated trade secrets. That's not a factual allegation. That's a legal conclusion. What did Mr. Liew put in the answer? Not, you know, don't tell them we were in the house raping somebody. Let's tell them we were in Oshkosh. They put, defendants have never misappropriated any information from DuPont. That is not a factual statement. That is a legal conclusion. That is a legal denial. They didn't put in the complaint anything about, we didn't get any material from Swan Yin and so forth and so on.
What about paragraph 32? I think for me that's the toughest paragraph you have to deal with in the answer.
Paragraph 32,
yes.
Right? Quote, including the answer to paragraph 32, that quote, defendants have never misappropriated any information from DuPont or any of its locations, including the Kwan Lin facility or otherwise. They haven't misappropriated it. that is a legal statement. It isn't a statement that we don't have information or never had information in our possession. And Mayerly's statement in the email is that no Kuan Yin design information has ever been obtained for our current design. For our current design. So, one, that isn't a statement that there isn't information. And the response here is not a statement they don't have information. It's a statement they never misappropriated.
Your response is that there's more of a legal response as opposed to a factual.
That's right. And if you make a legal response obstruction, then you're talking about making everybody who loses a civil case.
And that's how to get Judge Moore's law. Remembering her case and told nobody.
On sentencing. Not only did the government argue a sentencing theory that the loss was they were going to have a facility in China, which the court and the government and DuPont never mentioned below. So if you can reverse this and remand it back, and if they want to raise it, then they can. They're citing evidence to you without page citations. You look at the brief, there's not a single page citation. It then just offered you a second theory that the district court explicitly rejected. It says there was an intended loss, and you can have an intended loss. The district court said, no, there's no intended loss, and there's no measurement of loss. And finally, the question that you put, Your Honor, on I do believe that the opinion that must be written is that the amendments in the statute clarify that this has been the existing law since the passage of EEA in 1996, and therefore, because that was the law, the instructions consistent with it should have been given to the jury.
So, Chairino, you agree with the government that the amendments aren't going to make a difference?
I
extend.
Well, they will make a difference for this reason, Your Honor. I believe there's at least one case out there that said perhaps the EEA's definition of trade secrets deviated from the Uniform Trade Secret Act. This makes it clear that it didn't. So it certainly resolves that question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, counsel. Again, excellent argument. We had excellent argument today. The court always appreciates that. This matter is submitted, and we are in recess.